Hey guys, and welcome back to Allie and CoCo's Science Show! Yeah, I do sound a little funny. It's allergy season, but I like to think of it as
spooky season.
If you've been following us over on our social media, on our TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook, you know that we've been doing a little spooky science for you guys. And one of those weeks was witch botany. No, like witch botany. Like plants that witches used. And I had so much fun with it, and I kind of want to highlight it here on my YouTube channel. There is so much fascination with witches and witch folklore in media, so like Glinda the Good Witch and her sister, the Wicked Witch of the East. There's a more studious, kind of more normal Harry Potter style of witches. There's a more sinister, like eating children, luring men, hocus pocus kind of witches. And of course, the witches that create curses or tell fortunes, like in Macbeth or The Little Mermaid. Ursula is a sea witch, so there you go. Or, you know, not in media, there's a more religious or spiritual aspect of witch culture. Witch culture. Around the world and for hundreds of years. Far from it, CoCo. I love your bandana though, but that's far from the truth. So there was a time, starting in medieval Europe, maybe before, and there's still some happening today, but definitely a prominent time into colonial US history where they had witch trials. Ha ha, yeah. So basically, people were accusing other people of being witches, usually women. Women just living their lives, doing their thing. Maybe they were living alone and they had absolutely no proof, but they said, I think she's a witch, and they would execute them. And it's ridiculous, right? So ridiculous, in fact, that I think the scene from Monty Python and the Holy Grail perfectly encapsulates it.
What makes you think she's a witch?
Well, she turned me into a newt.
A newt.
I got better.
Many of the witch trials were based on hysteria, not fitting in a specific like religious or cultural box. And it was rude, Colette. For lack of a better word, it was very wrong and rude. Also historically, many people who were herbalists are retroactively called witches because they would have their gardens and they knew how to work with plants to help cure people's ailments or try and bring good fortune or happiness to people. They were basically like, a lot of them were pharmacists of the past, which is awesome. Look at you. Yeah. So today I wanted to talk about my five favorite plants associated with witch folklore. Now I've chosen ones that are kind of like steeped in media that you may have heard before, but you're like, what is that? So like rosemary, a little too obvious. So I tried to pick ones that are a little bit more different, but popular. So let's get into it. Number one, eye of newt, toad of frog. If you've ever read or seen or know of Macbeth by William Shakespeare, you may be familiar with the three witches. Which, they also have the name the Weird Sisters, and fun little connection, in the fourth Harry Potter book, the Weird Sisters play at the Yule Ball. Weird tangent, the three sisters are brewing up a potion, you know, double toil and bubble, like in Harry Potter. They add eye of newt and toe of frog. And no, Colette, no amphibians were harmed in the making of this potion. They're actually plants. I know. In fact, eye of newt is in my spice cabinet right now. I'm gonna go get it real quick. Got him. Check it out, guys. Eye of newt. It's not, these aren't newt eyeballs, they're mustard seeds. In the family Brassicaceae, in the genus Brassica, which includes like cabbage, Brussels sprouts, kale, cauliflower, a lot of our favorite vegetables. A lot of my favorite vegetables, that is. The biting taste we get from mustard, like when you put mustard on a hot dog, are caused by a compound called glycosinolates. And these compounds have been perfected over millions of years of evolution. See, the mustard seed, the brassica, had this compound, this secondary metabolite. within the leaf structure to prevent herbivory. Now, the caterpillars that take a bite of the leaf and are fine with it, they go on to pass those genes on and create a stronger and stronger caterpillar that can withstand the biting glycosinolates, which is so cool. So then the plant has to create more glycosinolates, which means the caterpillar has to have more resistance, and on and on and on. This kind of fun little like ongoing attempt of out-evolving each other is called an evolutionary arms race. And it happens so much in ecology and so fun to learn about. And I bet that biting taste is really good in a witch's brew. In fact, it might be something that could help out with a cold, a respiratory infection, also muscle pain, rubbing it on your skin as an ointment. I feel like I need a little bit of a witch's brew with Eye of Newt in it. But it does kind of look like newt eyeballs, I suppose. Okay, yes, toe of a frog is the buttercup. It has nothing to do with butter though. So buttercup is in the genus Ranunculus, and there are many different species around the world, like hundreds of species of Ranunculus. But something fun, rana is Latin for frog. These plants are often found near water in music habitats. And so their genus means frog, little frog, which is so cute. And so it's kind of fun to have the association of Tova frog with the Latin name. That's so cool. Buttercup. Hi, I'm going to start calling her Buttercup, I think. Yeah. Buttercup has a compound in it called ranunculin. When the plant is damaged, there's all these cool chemical pathways, and it goes from ranunculin to another compound to another compound and ends up with protoanemonin. This can cause sores in the mouth, diarrhea, colic, even livestock avoid the fresh flower. Plant number two, Atropa belladonna. Now I need to preface this by saying the plant looks amazing, but please, 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 please do not try and ingest any part of this plant. Even if I talk about how like people in the past use it for medicine, please, please, don't eat random plants, please. So Atropa belladonna is in the deadly nightshade family. Actually, on my most recent watch of Nightmare Before Christmas, I saw Sally use deadly nightshade perfectly. All parts of the plant are toxic. They contain a few different tropane alkaloids like atropine, scopolamine, and hyoscyamine. And it's considered one of the most toxic plants ever known. Actually, I was also watching Practical Magic, and this is the plant she uses to poison the creepy boyfriend, the abusive boyfriend.
Belladonna. It's a sedative. People put it in their tea to relax, calm their nerves.
Some people also use it as a poison.
Yeah. Ingesting too much can cause blurred vision, headache, loss of balance, dry mouth, hallucinations. It can even cause paralysis in some animals, so please don't eat it, Colette. But my botany professor always said the dose makes the poison. So if you have too much of something, it can be really harmful, but in a little bit amount, you could maybe have some beneficial effects. A little bit, but again, don't eat it, please. The name belladonna is Italian for beautiful women. And apparently, I believe it was a Renaissance period, women would ingest belladonna to create dilated pupils because that was hot back then. Literally, they were kind of poisoning themselves to look, have a certain beauty standard, which is like, but more recently it was used as a medicine. In the 1800s, people would have belladonna prescribed to them for IBS, stomach cramps, like excessive gas. I know, I could have used that last week. Like, I'm sorry. It could also calm your muscle and nervous system when necessary. However, when people gave it out as medicine, they took out a lot of those tropane alkaloids, made it a much, much smaller dose. Getting it back to witch folklore, legend has it that witches would create a flying ointment made with belladonna, monk's hood, poppy, and hemlock. And it would create a flying sensation for them. Probably because all those have a lot of tropane alkaloids that create a hallucinogenic effect. Pretty exciting though, right? Number three, wolfsbane. Oh, unimpressed, she is. One of my favorite mentions of this plant is in the first Harry Potter book. Snape asks,
"And what is the difference between monk's hood and wolfbane?"
"I don't
don't know, sir.
And in the deleted scenes of the movie and in the book, he goes in a full discussion and says, they're the same plant. And they are. This plant is in the genus Aconitum, and they are all known for having a really, really tall flower structure, like a monk's hood or something. It's perfectly evolved for long distance flying butterflies, moths, and the long tongued bees. And basically, they have kind of evolved to have this tall structure so that they try and go up and get the nectar in the nectaries. Sorry, not nectarine. What? They go up in there, they get the nectar, and in the process get covered in pollen, and then go on to the next plant and exchange that pollen. Pretty awesome adaptation. Now, a lot of times if plants have a really like wacky method of getting their pollinator covered in pollen with a lot of nutrient-rich nectar, there will be insects that kind of bite through and steal nectar. But the wolfsbane plant has an awesome way of stopping that. So, when an unsuitable pollinator tries to sneak through and get some good nectar, the plant produces and puts out a compound called aconitine. Basically, it's a neurotoxin and a cardiotoxin. It can cause diarrhea, vomiting, burning in the stomach, muscle weakness, and irregular heartbeat, paralysis, even like in ancient times, people would actually use wolfsbane and put it on the ends of their spears. Kind of like the bane of maybe a wolf they were hunting, perhaps? Yeah, I'm so sorry. Look at you. Living the life. Eating pumpkin biscuits. It is also the bane for vampires in Dracula. They use wolfsbane to harm, to get the vampires. It's also in Harry Potter in a second form because Snape creates a wolfsbane potion for Lupin so that he turns into a regular wolf instead of a werewolf at the full moon. In sticking with Harry Potter, let's talk about mandrakes. Or mandragora. Mandragora officinarum is an actual plant, and it does kind of look like a little baby. The mandrake plant, like others in the nightshade family, have compounds that can cause hallucinations, blurred vision, dry mouth, vomiting, rapid heart rate, and breathing issues due to some of those same tropane alkaloids. And these side effects carry into our medicinal uses and folklore. The dose makes a poison. Just like in Harry Potter, the roots and tubers look like human parts, kind of. And also there's a male and a female version, which I thought was pretty exciting. And in the screams of both folklore and Harry Potter, it was said that they could knock you out or in the past they actually had some pretty wacky ways of pulling the mandrake root out, including plugging their ears and employing the family farm dog, tying the mandrake root maybe to the tail of the dog and having the dog run and pull the tuber out. Very exciting, I know. So if you're having problems with your arm, you take the arm part of the root, make some sort of potion out of it, and that would cure your arm ailments or your leg, you know, etc., etc. It could also help with hallucinations or a long list of mental health issues that are under the umbrella term back in the day of mania and melancholy. It would also be used for like an anesthetic, because it would make you fall asleep, you know? This is foxglove, or digitalis. There's almost 30 species in the genus, and they're just so beautiful, breathtaking flowers that kind of look like little digits. Digitalis, huh, huh, huh? They have all sorts of colors, patterns. They're beautiful in gardens, they attract a lot of fun pollinators, and yet they're real freaking toxic with what are called cardiac glycosides that can cause a lot of heart issues among other things. But they're so beautiful and they're all over. I'm sure, like, I've seen them in gardens before. Very popular plant, yet can be really harmful to people, especially small children and small animals. So don't eat foxglove. When you consume part of a foxglove plant, you are consuming many different compounds, but notably digoxin. Depending on the state of your heart, it can slow your heart down, it can start your heart racing. So many different things can happen, and they're all probably not good. It can also cause severe headaches, diarrhea, jaundiced vision, tremors, convulsions, drooling, seizures, and, you know, again, it could you. I know. Now, it also gets the name witch's glove, dead men's bells. It has actually, it has one of, it's one of the plants with the most common names, which I actually find kind of fun. I know a lot of scientists prefer scientific names, and I do too, but common names also are fun and can teach a lot about the folklore and the uses of it from the past, including like if dew, like D-E-W, collected on the flower, it was said to attract fairies, so some people call them fairy bells. I love that. For a while, it was used by herbalists for heart issues. They would prescribe it to people in certain doses if they needed to regulate their heart rate, or for epilepsy. Apparently, Van Gogh took digoxin for his epilepsy, which is really kind of cool. Yeah, it is a really cool plant, actually. And like the patterns are so cool. And it's something that in science we believe helps lead bees, especially into where the pollen is, where the nectar is. So those patterns have a purpose. It's not just to look cute, although like, you know. So those are my five favorite witch botany. So comment down below for the question of the week. I wanna know, what is your favorite witch-themed plant? It can be one of these or it can be another one. I already told you, mine is foxglove. I think it's so cool, the kind of the folklore and story behind it, but also the science behind it is just cool. And they look beautiful, my God. Who, what about you? Rosemary. I love rosemary. It was the first plant Colette learned. And that one was also used in practical magic to keep away evil spirits. Oh my God. So don't forget to comment down below what is your favorite witch-themed plant. And don't forget to thumbs up this video if you learned something new or you're excited for Halloween puppies. Colette will not be dressing up because she hates human clothes. So I'm sorry, but I hope you guys have a fun Halloween, you stay safe, and don't forget to hit that subscribe button if you want to follow for more adventures. Check out the social media links down below, as well as any other links I might have for more information, and we'll see you again next time. Bye! Do you want to play ball? Your ball's actually back here, did you know that? Go get it, go on. Thanks for watching. Go get it, go on, go. Go, 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 go. Okay guys, well, we'll see you next time. Bye. Happy Halloween.